Welcome to Frank Buckley Interviews and our special Academy Awards program with two Oscar nominees for Best Production Design and Best Music Original Score. My guests tonight are Fiona Crombie for The Favorite and Terence Blanchard for BlacKkKlansman.
Frank Buckley Interviews starts now.
As production designer for The Favorite, Fiona Crombie was just honored with the British equivalent of Oscar with a BAFTA award. She was responsible for everything you see in The Favorite.
You know, we built our carriages. I'm worrying about how many rabbits are black, white, what's happening in the room, what's the furniture, what walls are we building. So pretty much everything that you're looking at, with the exception of the people, it comes under my department.
Terence Blanchard scored the music for Spike Lee's film BlacKkKlansman, and he just won a Grammy Award for Best Instrumental Composition for one of the songs on the soundtrack. Now he's nominated for an Oscar.
What I do is he, Spike doesn't like to hear any synthetic instrument, or he wants to hear it all on the piano. Mm. So I may come up with 12 melodies, and with those 12 melodies, I'll just send them to him. He'll sit there and listen to them and absorb them. And then when we get to the point where we start to spot the film, to go through the film scene by scene to figure out where the music goes, that's when he'll tell me. He said, hey man, I hear this as this theme.
Two Academy Award nominees on our program tonight, Terence Blanchard and Fiona Crombie, when we come back. Fiona, welcome and congratulations on your Oscar nomination.
Thank you very much.
How does that sound, Oscar nomination?
I know. I'm not tired of it. I quite like that, yeah.
Well, it's a beautiful film, The Favorite, and if people haven't seen it, I have. I saw it in a theater. It's quirky and delicious, and it's a period film, 18th century England, but it has these moments that sort of bring you to modern day, and there's this dance sequence in particular that I really enjoyed. Starts out as sort of the classic, I don't know, royal dance scene, and then they sort of do modern dance.
Yeah.
It's like a soul train.
Yeah.
And that was sort of just to give people a sense of what the film is like.
Yeah.
That scene in particular, how do you, as the production designer, and you were nominated for production design and for Alice Felton for set decoration on the film, how do you two work together with the director to create that scene?
Well, one of the key things for us that was throughout the entire film is that my department had to light the film.
Mm.
You know, we used only natural light and candlelight.
Really?
And so there's no artificial light in the film. And so the biggest challenge for me when you talk about that scene was, how do I light this room and how do I light these people? And so we brought in so many candelabra and we just stacked that room. And we had to be really, you know, compositional about it so it didn't look chaotic, and we had to sort of make it feel like you would believe it. It wasn't, you know, just putting candelabras right next to everybody.
Yeah.
And so that, I remember there being a lot of discussion about how to basically light the action, because there was no hanging point. There was no way I could hang a chandelier. It was all basically side lit from our candelabra.
Mm. I didn't know that you didn't use lighting, and to hear that just seems impossible to shoot that scene and all the others, because this palace is dark in some spots.
Yes. Well, that's the thing. I mean, we were really, we knew that that was the idea. And so we did things like, you know, I put a lot of mirrors in the spaces and I uncovered floors and we like really gave them a proper shine, and we looked at ways to bounce light. You know, there's massive fireplaces. We made sure they were always lit. You know, so things like that we were just constantly finding ways that were authentic that you could bounce light. But we also, I mean, realistically, we put in more candles than ever would have been there. We also had them off camera. You know, we would put them in corners to kind of give some shape to a room. And
we went through 80,000
candles. That was my prop master's, you know, estimate. It was in the realm of 80,000 candles.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
So help me. I should have asked this first, but I'll back up and say, you know, what does a production designer do? Because it's one of those credits we see. It's something that I've read or heard, that you're sort of responsible for the visual look and feel of a film. But take me through the process. Yorgos comes to you and says, I want you to be my production designer on The Favourite.
You know, my job is, I am, you know, technically responsible for the look of everything in the film, with the exception of costumes and makeup. So I'm looking at, you know, we built our carriages. I'm worrying about how many rabbits are black, white, you know, like spotty, you know, like, you know, all of those things. What's the food, you know, that's on offer? You know, what's happening in the room? What's the furniture? What walls are we building? So pretty much everything that you're looking at, with the exception of the people, it comes under my department. And so much of my job is about communicating. It's about understanding what the director would like and, you know, growing that and offering things back, and then communicating that to my people that work with me, and making choices, like, you know, deciding which path to travel with, you know, whether it's the palette or, you know, textures. And so, yeah, that's what I do.
It sounds like part designer, part historian, part obviously manager, leader. And you have to meld all those things at once.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you have to understand. You have to understand the world that you're trying to create. The biggest thing is to being able to communicate that. You know, to be able to have your team have a shorthand, and I do that with a lot of visual work, like lots of referencing, and, you know, make it very clear what we're all pursuing, and then we can just get on and do it. But you do have to kind of tick a lot of boxes, but you have a great team. I had an amazing team, tiny team, but a great team.
So there is a scene where the character that Emma plays is coming up these stairs, these beautiful stairs, and now we know that that's naturally lit. And then she emerges into a corridor and then approaches a sentry or a guard at the Queen's bedroom.
Shall I tell the doctor you imperiled the Queen's health and let you brew the ramifications?
What does ramification?
It means he will have you whipped.
And then she emerges into the room. And this room has tapestries on the wall. It has furniture. It has food. It has a bed.
Yeah.
All of those things are thoughtfully placed there.
Yeah. Absolutely. We made the bed. So the bed was, it's a pretty faithful, you know, version of a queen's bed for that period. We made it a little bit higher because we were very interested in having it really a looming object, you know, this real play on scale in the space. And we had that made in the north of England and hand carved and hand painted. So there's a lot of attention to those kind of, you know, very special details. And we wanted, the room to feel like it's full of jewels, you know, whether it's a bed or a beautiful piece of glassware, you know, it's all those kind of things. But yeah, it should be quite overwhelming for Abigail at that point to come in and be in the inner sanctum and to see, you know, how this woman lives. So
I
don't worry
about
it.
You almost don't want me to focus on the things in the room, because then that means I'm not following the
100%.
Story.
I mean, for me, my great pleasure, the reason I make films is because I'm interested in characters and I love framing for characters. I like providing their landscape, you know, whether it's, you know, a bedroom or it's, you know, whatever it is. I love to kind of try to tease out some kind of little quiet narrative that I can provide. And that's my pleasure. And I like offering spaces where the character stands out. You know, they're not overwhelmed by it's too much staff or, you know, I love to see it. I love characters. So, you know, I want to give them their world.
Are you working on something right now?
I'm not.
You're available.
I am. I'm available. But yeah, no, it's, I finished something last year and I've just been having a quiet time. I'm reading scripts and things. So I'm considering my options. But, no, I tend to do one job a year. I've got two children, so, like, you know.
Well, Fiona Crombie is available. So Hollywood, here she is. Thank you so much and congratulations.
Pleasure. Thank you so much too.
As production design is key to our visual experience of a film, the score, the music, is crucial to our audio experience. The jazz musician and composer who scored Spike Lee's BlacKkKlansman is Terence Blanchard. Terence, welcome to Frank Buckley Interviews, and congratulations on your Oscar nomination.
Thank you very much. I'm happy to be here.
You have been doing this for such a long time. We have been appreciating your music in films for a long time. I was looking at your IMDb credit list. 68 films or TV shows as a composer.
Yes.
And, of course, you've played in many others as well. Some of the films, just to so folks know, with Spike Lee alone, Jungle Fever,
yes.
Malcolm X, 25th Hour, Summer of Sam, my favorite, Inside Man, now BlacKkKlansman, nominated for original score. And before we get into how is this your first nomination, which is something I found shocking, how did you find out?
Oh, you know, I teach at Berklee College of Music, so I was in Boston and I share an apartment with my daughter who's also going to school there. And I just happened to be up early in the morning. I forgot it was the day of the nominations, you know. And I just called my wife because I had a feeling she was up early. And she was. And she was the one who reminded me what was going on that day. But then my daughter came in and grabbed the phone and goes, "Oh, hey, Mommy," and took the phone out of the room. And she started talking to her. And I literally could hear my wife scream over the phone.
Oh.
You know, and then my daughter came in. "Daddy, you got nominated. You got nominated."
That's
nice.
It
was really cool. It was really cool.
As I mentioned before, this is just the latest in a long collaboration with Spike Lee, BlacKkKlansman.
Yeah.
And is it true that you were first brought into Spike's world by his father, who is also a music man, a composer, who did the original scores for Spike's first student films, then his first films.
Right.
And then he asked for you to come perform.
Yeah, well, you know, it was interesting. So Spike's dad, when they were doing school days, they thought about putting together a big band full of young and old jazz musicians. So Spike's dad had a friend named Harold Vick, who was the contractor, and he knew all of us. So he hired us and put us together. And that's how it all started. And it was really great, man, because I didn't think about being a film composer until I saw Spike's dad do it, you know. And then they did the same thing for Do the Right Thing. And then with More Better Blues, you know, they call us in to pre-record the music for the actors, sing to in the club scenes. And we took a break, man. I'm sitting at the piano playing something that I was working on for my first album for Columbia Records, my first solo project. And Spike walks by. You know, Spike goes, "Hey, man, what's that?" And I go, "It's a thing I've written for these kids that were massacred in South Africa. It's called Sing Soweto, something I'm going to use on my album." He goes, "You mind if I use it?" And I said, "No, not at all." So at the time, we recorded it just as a solo trumpet piece. And the only reason why I'm laughing is because once you got it back to the editing room, you know, they tried to fill it up and they realized that they needed an orchestral arrangement for it. So he calls me up and he goes, "Hey, man, you think you can write some strings for this?" You know, man, it is one of those moments where you said that. He said, "Now, do I tell the truth or do I lie?"
Because you didn't feel confident doing that?
No, I'd never done it at all. You know what I mean? I studied composition, but I never studied orchestration.
Right.
So I lied. I said, "Sure, man, whatever you need," you know? And I literally get off the phone and I call my composition teacher. Literally, right after that, I go, "Hey, his name is Roger Dickinson." I go, "Hey, Roger, man, I got this project, man. What do I do?" And you know, I thought Roger was going to give me the magic words of wisdom and tell me exactly what to do. And he said, "Trust your training."
Trust your training.
Yeah. He said that was it. And that's what I did.
Wow.
And we've been working together ever since.
Let me get back to that thing that I mentioned at the beginning. This is your first Oscar nomination after all this amazing work over the years. And did that ever annoy you, make you think this isn't right? Do you have some explanation as to why you never got the nod?
No, I don't have an explanation why I never got the nod, but it didn't annoy me because, you know, you can never miss what you never had.
Mm.
You know what I mean? So I didn't think of it like that. And for me, the way that I was trained from the time that I went to the arts high school is that all of these are endeavors or artistic experiences to help you grow and expand.
Mm.
So I was never looking for that type of recognition. Now Spike was always advocating for me, you know, all the time. but it didn't really bother me like that. I just assumed that I wasn't on people's radar. And that was fine, you know, because I felt blessed enough to have the experiences, you know, to work with as many people. I got a chance to work with George Lucas, you know what I mean? I got
on
a chance to
work with Red Tails.
On Red Tails, you know. So I got a chance to work with a lot of great people, and that was enough for me, you know, because I've been learning a lot, and those experiences are the things that helped me develop to the point where I can write an opera, you know. And so the work has been always been the most important thing. But once you get recognized, it's such a shock to the system, you know, that it's you feel forever changed. And I feel proud to be a part of a historic moment, you know, where there's been a sea change, you know, and that's been dealing with a diversity issue, you know, when it comes to the Oscars. To see all of the people come up and take the picture the other day was powerful.
All right, let's talk about that process. Mm-hmm. You've worked with Spike for so long that I suspect you don't have to say a lot, but take me through the process of, okay, Spike has this film, and I want you to score it. Here we go. What happened?
Well, what I'll do is Spike doesn't like to hear any synthetic instrument, or he wants to hear it all on the piano. I may come up with 12 melodies, and with those 12 melodies, I'll just send them to him. He'll sit there and listen to them and absorb them. And then when we get to the point where we start to spot the film, to go through the film scene by scene to figure out where the music goes, that's when he'll tell me. He said, hey, man, I hear this as this theme. I'll hear this as that theme.
When you are scoring a film, do you want me to hear your music? Do you want me to go, oh, yeah, that's Terence Blanchard. That's one of his scores. Yeah. Or do you want me to not hear it, or is it some mix of those two?
That's a great question, because, you know, I'm always the guy when it comes to film that tries to be in the background, but Spike wants you to hear the music.
Yeah,
for sure. I mean, you know, he'll tell me. I mean, sometimes, you know, there'll be scenes and, man, he'll just ride the music. And I've learned over the course of time working with him, if there's ever a moment where there's no dialogue, that's my spot. If you think of BlacKkKlansman, the shooting range scene with the jigaboos, with the metal, right? I knew when I saw that, and I saw John David walking in, and there's no dialogue, it's just him experiencing that moment by himself. I knew immediately that was just going to be a moment for music, you know. And I tried to write it in such a way where it didn't overpower the scene, you know, because you can easily do that, but it showed the startling emotional realization that he had.
That's an incredible thing for me to think about, because I thought about how you look at this print, you don't hear the music,
right?
You hear the dialogue, because there is no music,
right?
That's your job. And you have so many choices at that moment.
Ooh,
right?
Yeah, exactly.
You could go crazy.
Yes.
You could be super subtle.
Mm-hmm.
You could try to let that scene play without music.
Right, right.
So how do you, and do you question yourself as you're going? And
that's one of the things I was talking about. My kids try to stay out of my way, because I'm always, if they walk by the door, I'm like, come here.
You do?
Come here. Yeah, oh, all the time.
And you like what, play it on a?
I play it for them. I have a studio and I have a big screen and the whole nine. And, you know, I'll play it for them and I'll go, tell me what you think, you know. No, Daddy. I'm like, no. Tell me what you think, you know. And because I try to get people's natural reactions, because I know that I'm sitting in the room all day, every day,
right?
And I know sometimes objectivity can go out the window. So you do become a little fearful of like, am I going too far or am I not going far enough, you know? Because even though I know what Spike wants, you know, Spike loves music. He loves music, and I know that I could probably push things a lot further, and he will accept it. but that doesn't mean it'll be the best thing for the film.
That's interesting.
Yeah, it won't. You know, so that's always my dilemma at home when I'm working.
Because he will want you to go a little more crazy.
Definitely.
And you, as the person who's in charge of the score, you don't think that's the right thing beat to hit.
Well, I think sometimes it's like it's because you have to think of the overall story. You know, I don't want it to be a moment where all of a sudden the music just goes, and everybody goes, "Hey, man, what was that?"
Right.
You know what I mean? I want it to be more of a thing where it's an emotional push. You know, where you see him, because that scene starts with him, you know, in the grass, you know, and it's a beautiful thing, and you don't know what he's looking at because he's just out there in the grass just hanging out. Then all of a sudden his emotions change, and then we see what he's looking at. That's what the music is supposed to do. The music is supposed to take us from that beautiful moment into something that's darker, you know, but still emotional. And I what I try to do is to make sure that it'll swell and it'll get big, you know, but it's not going to be too busy, you know, and it's not going to be a moment that's going to, because he's standing there thinking, and you have to wonder, like, what's on his mind seeing this? And then as he walks past it, that emotion is, he's carrying that with him as he's walking away. So the music has to stay with that.
Well, we're not supposed to root for people, but we'll be rooting for you, Terence.
Thank you. I appreciate it, man.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Thanks for all the support. It's been great.
My thanks again to Fiona Crombie and Terence Blanchard for terrific conversations. We just shared a portion of each conversation on today's program. If you'd like to hear the entire in-depth conversation with each one of our Academy Award nominees, go to the Frank Buckley Interviews podcast. It's available wherever you listen to podcasts. Which films are you rooting for at the Academy Awards? Tag me on social media with the answer. I'm Frank Buckley TV on Twitter and on Instagram, and there's a Frank Buckley Facebook page as well. I'll look forward to reading your comments. If you want to share today's program with your friends, we'll post it on YouTube. Just search for Frank Buckley Interviews, Fiona Crombie, and Terence Blanchard. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time.